Hello, this is Professor Kitch, and welcome to this webcast from my Introduction to Geotechnical Engineering course. This webcast is from Chapter 4 of the textbook and covers sections 4.1 through 4.3 on the particulate nature of soils and three-phase diagrams. When you've completed this webcast, you should be able to describe the three-phase nature of soil, draw three-phase diagrams representing soil, complete a three-phase diagram by computing the weights and volumes of the soil phases, and using a completed three-phase diagram, you should be able to compute the unit weight, or gamma, the dry unit weight, gamma sub D, the porosity, N, the saturation, S, the void ratio, E, and the moisture content, or sometimes called water content, W. So, let's get into solving weight volume problems using three-phase diagrams. When we examine soil, we see that it is not a continuous mass like steel or some other engineering materials. It's a particulate material consisting of three distinct parts or phases: the solid mineral particles, air or other gases, and water or other liquids. We use the three-phase diagram to represent the particulate nature of soil. The lower box in the diagram represents the soil particles. The middle box represents the water or other fluids, and the top box represents the air or gas portion of the soil. The left side of the diagram will represent the weights of each phase using units of either pounds or kilonewtons, and the right side of the diagram will represent the volumes of each phase using the units of either cubic feet or cubic meters. On the weight side, we use W sub S to represent the weight of the solids, W sub W to represent the weight of the water, and W sub T to represent the total weight. The weight of the air or gas is zero. On the volume side, we use V sub S to represent the volume of the solids, V sub W to represent the volume of the water, and V sub A to represent the volume of the air. V sub T represents the total volume. We also define the variable V sub V to represent the volume of the voids. The volume of the voids is equal to the volume of the water plus the volume of the air. It can be convenient to draw the three-phase diagram using mass instead of weight. When we use this method, we almost always use SI units. The mass units are expressed in grams, and the volume is expressed in cubic centimeters. In this form, the left side of the equation uses M sub S to represent the mass of solids, M sub W to represent the mass of water, and M sub T to represent the total mass. The variables for the volumes on the right side of the figure are the same as before. We'll explain later when it's useful to use this formulation. There are two different types of problems that appear when working with phase diagrams. The first type of problem appears when we are given exact quantities for the soil component phases. Here, we are given weights in pounds or kilonewtons and volumes in cubic meters or cubic feet. The second type of a problem appears when we are given relative quantities of the soil component phases. Here, we are given quantities such as the degree of saturation, the water content, or porosity. This webcast covers the first type of problems. The second type will be covered in a separate webcast. So here's a type 1 example problem. We're given a cylindrical specimen of soil 2.4 inches in diameter and 6 inches tall. We weigh the specimen and determine it has a total weight of 1.95 pounds. We then put the specimen in an oven overnight to dry it out and weigh it again the next day. It now weighs 1.65 pounds. Since all the water has been removed by oven drying, this represents W sub S, the weight of the solids. We will assume that the specific gravity of the solids is 2.66. We are asked to determine the total unit weight, dry unit weight, void ratio, porosity, and water content. We'll start our solution process by creating a three-phase diagram. On the left side of the diagram, we will record the weight in pounds, and on the right side, we'll record the volume in cubic feet. Starting on the left side, we'll enter the information we already know. The total weight is 1.95 pounds, and the weight of the solids is 1.65 pounds. It's easy to determine the weight of the water as the total weight minus the weight of the solids, or 1.95 minus 1.65, which gives us the weight of the water as 0.30 pounds, and we record this on the diagram. We now move to the volume side of the diagram. Since we know the original dimensions of the specimen, we first compute the total volume as pi r squared times the height of the specimen, or pi times 2.5 inches divided by 2, quantity squared, times 6 inches. However, this will give us the volume in cubic inches, and we want it in cubic feet. To make this conversion from cubic inches to cubic feet, we multiply by 1 foot over 12 inches, quantity cubed. This will give us the proper units in cubic feet. Completing this computation, we determine the total volume of 0.0157 cubic feet, and we record that on the diagram. We now must use the unit weight of water and the unit weight of the solid phase to convert the weights on the left-hand side of the equation to volumes on the right. I usually start with the water because, like every good civil engineer, I long ago memorized that the unit weight of water was 62.4 pounds per cubic foot, or 9.81 kilonewtons per cubic meter. So, the volume of the water is 0.30 pounds divided by 62.4 pounds per cubic foot, or 0.0048 cubic feet, which we record on the diagram. The volume of the solids will be equal to the weight of the solids divided by the unit weight of the solids. However, we have to use the specific gravity of the solids and the unit weight of water to get this quantity. So the volume of the solids will be equal to 1.65 pounds divided by 2.66, the specific gravity of the solids, divided by 62.4 pounds per cubic foot. This gives us a value of 0.0099 cubic feet, which we then record on the diagram. Next, we compute the volume of air by subtracting the volume of solids and the volume of water from the total volume. This computation is 0.0157 minus 0.0048 minus 0.0099, which equals 0.0010 cubic feet of air. Finally, we record the volume of voids by summing the volume of water and air. So the void volume is 0.0010 plus 0.0048, or 0.0058. And now we have a complete three-phase diagram with the weights and volumes of all phases. The last step of the problem is to solve for the quantities we're interested in using the information on the phase diagram. First, we compute the total unit weight as the total weight divided by the total volume, or 1.95 pounds divided by 0.0157 cubic feet. This gives us 124.2 pounds per cubic foot. The dry unit weight is computed as the weight of solids divided by the total volume, or 1.65 pounds divided by 0.0157 cubic feet. This gives us 105.1 pounds per cubic foot. Next, we compute the void ratio. Remember that the void ratio is one of those weird soil properties where it's based on the amount of the solid material rather than the amount of the total material. The void ratio is the volume of voids divided by the volume of solids, not the total volume. This is 0.058 cubic feet divided by 0.0099 cubic feet, or 0.586. By convention, the void ratio is presented in decimal form rather than as a percentage. The porosity is similar to the void ratio, except it's based on the total volume of material. The porosity is computed as the volume of the voids divided by the total volume, or 0.058 divided by 0.0157 times 100%. The porosity is most commonly presented as a percentage. This helps to keep it from being confused with the void ratio. For our specimen, the porosity is 38.9%. The degree of saturation is computed as the volume of water divided by the volume of voids, or 0.0048 divided by 0.0058 times 100%. This gives us a degree of saturation of 82.8%. Finally, we compute the moisture content, or water content, as the mass of water divided by the mass of solids. The moisture content, like the void ratio, is based on the quantity of solid material rather than the total quantity of material. For our specimen, this will be 0.30 pounds divided by 1.65 pounds times 100%, or 18.2%. So now our problem is complete. It's important to remember to use the three-phase diagram. It may be tempting to compute quantities such as the unit weight and the water content by using equations directly without first creating a three-phase diagram. However, I can assure you that in the long run, you will learn this material faster and you will make fewer mistakes if you create a three-phase diagram first. So do yourself a favor and always draw a three-phase diagram. I'm Professor Kitch, and I hope you found this webcast helpful.